Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Today's topic is, what is salvation and how to be saved? What is the true salvation? Salvation is to be saved from the wrath of God, since we do not obey God. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. That is, God will love you if you do not love the world. Verse 16, for all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Lust of the flesh refers 99% to illicit sex. Lust of the eyes is our admiration for worldly glamour. And pride of life is our pride. Verse 17, and the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. All these things are attractive, desirable, and give pleasure. This pleasure may last as long as we live. But if we believe in eternity, this life is, say, 100 years, and eternity will be for millions of years. The pleasure in heaven is thousands of times more enjoyable than the worldly pleasures. Further, if we do not do what God tells us to do, there will be punishments. Real salvation comes by avoiding these three things and inherit the kingdom of God rather than to be punished by God. This is the true salvation. But this is not what Christians mean when they say that they are saved. They refer to some incidents, perhaps with emotional experience, that could have happened on a certain day, and because of that, they are saved. Such a salvation is not according to the Bible. Yet, it is unanimously accepted as salvation in churches. It is fake and deceptive salvation. Religion cannot save anyone. Chief priests, high priests, ordinary priests, elders, Pharisees, scribes, and Sadducees all were in the temple. They supposed to represent God. But John the Baptist called them as a generation of vipers. And Jesus Christ called them as sons of the devil. Jesus Christ told them, you hypocrites, you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, and you neither go in yourself, neither suffer others to go in. So they forced Romans to kill Jesus on the cross. So also present-day Christians, or Christian churches, is the exact replica of the Old Testament Judaism. At that time, God became a man to be killed. He came to sacrifice himself. And that's why they were able to kill him. But for the last 2,000 plus years, Jesus Christ is here with us as God in the omnipotent spirit. Now, churches cannot kill him. So they have rejected him and worship the legend Jesus, and who is the imaginary projection of the man Jesus as God. The Bible says that he is another Jesus and false Christ. The true Jesus Christ, who is in the omnipotent spirit, is here, and he is our God. Christians go to church for their salvation, but they do not even recognize the true Jesus Christ and who is God. Christians are making the same mistakes as Jews made when Jesus came in as a man. Religion cannot give us salvation. Only God Jesus, who is in the omnipotent spirit, who is with us, can give us salvation. How God saves us or takes us to heaven? Matthew chapter 1 verse 21 says, call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. That is, Jesus Christ will save his people from their sins. Then they will inherit heaven. And 1 John chapter 3 verse 8, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Acts chapter 3, 26. First, God, having raised up his Son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning every one of you from his iniquities. Jesus Christ has come to this world to save his people from sinning. And sinning is a work of the devil. So Jesus Christ removes the sinning from his people and destroys the work of Satan. Philippians chapter 2 verse 12 says, as you have always obeyed, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. We must obey God for our salvation. As we obey God, God will fulfill our salvation. Romans chapter 3 verse 25 says, God declares his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. So God forbears until we become obedient, and then only he forgives our past sins, which will make our salvation complete. We're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. In Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1, Ephesians, book of Ephesians. Chapter 2 verse 1. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. God says we were dead. We were not physically dead, but God calls us dead since we were in trespasses and sins. God quickens us. God brought us to life. He pulled us out of trespasses and sins. That's how he made us live again. And verses to same chapter, chapter 2, Ephesians, verses 5 and 6. Verses 5. Even when we were dead in sins, he quickened together with Christ. By grace we are saved. Verse 6, and hath raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. God pulled us out of sins, placed us in Christ and in heavenly places, and says, by grace you are saved. Now the salvation is done, we are saved. But what has happened in the real life? It is, everybody quote this, everybody say this, we have a kind of understanding. But usually we will not connect this to our real life. But what is in the real life? Verses 2 and 3. Verses 2. Where in time past you walked according to the courses of this world. You, whatever the world did, you have done. According to the prince of the power of air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. You disobey God, the one who working in you is the spirit of the world. That is Satan. Verse 3. Among whom also we have had our conversation in time past. In time past, see, he says, before, in time past we were doing this. At the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. See, our past life changed now. It was the past life. What is in real life? The past, we are according to the world and according to the devil, we are doing all kind of disobeying God, all kind of things which disobey God. But now we are changed. We were disobedient in the flesh and the mind, but now we are obedient. That is, we were sinners before, now we are righteous. This is salvation. But churches set up a perfect trap and we fall right to it and die. That is, they want us to be religious. Teach us the verses. See, that's a trick. They teach us these verses, make us memorize it and get excited with the verses, but we will not connect this with our life. Our life never changed. We become religious, quoting the verses, singing songs, those kind of things. Our life become the worldly things, and we adopt the religious, also religion and world together. We never come out of the worldly sins and we embrace Christ. Okay, we are placed in Christ. But that will not happen in real life if we become religious. It is not salvation. Memorizing scriptures is not salvation, but salvation is living by the scriptures. God gives eternal salvation to only those who obey Him. Another false teaching in the churches is that Jesus Christ died on the cross to take our punishment, and He died in our place. That's what they say, in our place, instead of us. He died, so we don't have to die. God the Father punished Him instead of He punishing us, so that we may go to heaven. That's a lie and fabrication of the devil. But most Christians believe this, because it is so enticing and very easy. He died it and we don't have to sweat, so we got the salvation free. So that is the things they sell, but that's fake. Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the whole world, but He did not burn in hell for the whole world. Our punishment for sins, if we are punished, why are we punished? God is not crucifying us in the cross. Our punishment will be in hell, to burn in hell for eternity, not to be crucified in the cross. If Jesus took our punishment, that's what the preachers say, He took our punishment. If He took our punishment, He could have been still burning in the hell for eternity. Jesus was not cast in the hell in our place. But He died on the cross. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 8 says, by the things which He suffered, that refers to the death on the cross, He suffered. He didn't burn in hell, He suffered the cross. He became the author of salvation unto them that obey. He became the author. It's an entirely different phenomenon. Point number one in here, by dying on the cross, He became the author of eternal salvation. He became the authority to save other people. He's not taking the punishment. He became the author. He became somebody which is authority to give salvation. Point number two, He will give eternal salvation only to those who obey Him. That's what the scripture says. So, those who do not obey Him will not be saved. I be servants to God, give fruits unto holiness. Romans chapter 6, verse 16. Romans 6, verse 16. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, His servants you are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. If you do sin, you are servants to sin, and you will face eternal death, which is hell. But if you obey God, you will live a righteous life. And verse 22 says, the same chapter, says that you will inherit eternal life. And verse 17, but God be thanked that you were servants of sin. That is past. Your serving sin was past. You were servants to sin. But you have obeyed. You obeyed. You're talking to the people. If you are disobedient, you're not talking about you. You're talking about those people who obeyed. Now, you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. So, the apostles gave the doctrine to live obedient to Jesus Christ, they were living. They were servants to sin in the past, but now they obeyed the commandments of Jesus Christ. As you obey Jesus, his blood cleanses you from all unrighteousness, which was the root cause of all sins. And God forgives your past sins, as in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 to 9 says that, in Romans 3, 25, past sins are forgiven when you walk in the light as Jesus Christ is in the light. Romans 6, 18 says, being then made free from sin, you became servants of righteousness. So, now we serve God doing righteousness, but not committing sin. And verse 22, but now being made free from sin and became servants to God, you have fruits unto holiness, and the end is everlasting life. When you fruits unto holiness. Fruits means you show the fruits. That's our life. We live in holy life. It's our life. And we will obey him. We will live righteously and with holiness. The end will everlasting life. This is our salvation from the Lord Jesus Christ. The purpose of God in salvation is to beget sons for himself. God who created all things lives in a glorious place called heaven. God created people, his primary purpose of creating people in his own image, give them Holy Spirit, is to beget sons from them. In the process, many will attain heaven also. God created Adam and Eve and the whole world of people through them. He gives commandments to them, to the people, to choose the obedient, grants them spirit and power to become holy and perfect, purifies them to the point that they are without spot or wrinkle. Sometimes we read these verses, we say that's impossible, that's not true, and a lot of people pick up fights. We cannot become perfect. Okay, you don't have to be perfect, leave us alone. So that's the world. Let's go on. And he will raise them the same glory as Jesus Christ. When we see him, we will look like him. That is 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. So, and he will declare us as his sons. They will live with him. We will live with Jesus Christ as his children in heaven, as God's children, God's children, sons in heaven. Thus God begets children for himself. When we become his sons, then God begets us as his children. That's a declaration. They will live eternally in the status of the sons of God, and as sons will be joiners with Jesus Christ. James chapter 1 verse 18 says, of his own will he beget us. Romans 8, 17 says, if children then heirs and heirs of God and join heirs with Christ. Join heirs, that means as Jesus is a owner of heaven, we'll also get ownership there. That's inheritance. If you like to study this in detail, I have placed the links in the description section and with a transcript. You can study that. God saves multitude, but he seats only a few in his throne. Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. Verses 9 and 12. Verse 9. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. After this, behold, and lo, a great multitude of people, which no man could number, of all nations and kindred and the people and tongues, stood before the throne, and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, and palms in their hands, they're celebrating. They were all happy, but they were standing before. Verse 10, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, who sitteth upon the throne unto the Lamb. So the Lamb, Jesus Christ, was sitting on the throne of God, and then great multitude shouts of glory, and Jesus is seated on the throne, and it's also called salvation. So to be seated on the throne is a part of salvation. Two kinds of people will sit on the throne of God. And Matthew chapter 19, two kinds of people will sit on the throne. Matthew chapter 19, verses 27 and 28. Then answered Peter and said unto him, Behold, we have forsaken all and followed thee, and we sacrifice all this, we followed everything, what will we have? Then a lot of preachers revile Peter for this statement, and they think they are cool, and Peter is a kind of stupid or dumb. That's what they think. They preach sermons. We're not going into that. But let's go to the answer, what Jesus Christ gave him. Verse 28. And Jesus said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that you have followed me in the resurrection, when the Son of Man shall sit on the throne. So that's what we just saw. The Son of Man will sit on his throne of glory. You shall sit upon 12 thrones. So when Jesus said, when I sit on the throne, you will also sit on the throne. So the disciples who forsook worldly things and followed Jesus Christ will also sit in the throne of glory. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 21, Jesus Christ says, To him that overcometh, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am sit down in my Father's throne. As Jesus Christ overcome, if you overcome, then you will also sit in the throne as I said. That was it. The people will overcome sins, world and Satan, as Jesus Christ overcame. God gives them power for that. They will also sit in the throne of Jesus Christ. It is salvation. It is available to us. But the price is very high. Please notice that there will be a great multitude of people stood before the throne and they were celebrating. They are also there. Multitude of peoples were there and a few people were sit in the throne. There are two kinds of status we see there. They are not the throne, they are standing before. And when the people who are not in the throne, the multitude, they don't have to pay the high price either. Okay, now, there are four different status in heaven. God gives different calls to different people. If you as disciples, some of them call me as disciples, some of them are witnesses, are servants, and the rest of us, I call them as believers, those who believe in. So that's, and those who have become perfect and have another call to become his bride. So four callings, four status of callings. So there are four different levels of callings. And there are four different levels of heaven also. If you have known and obeyed your calling, you are saved. And you will attain heaven in that level. For example, if you are an ordinary believer, you are expected to do only two things. Love God with reverence and fear. The next one is, don't do any harm to your neighbor. Those two. Love God and love your neighbor. If you do those two, and you will escape the punishment of God, that is, you will be saved. If you are strong enough, if you think, oh, that's too small, I'm not going to be an ordinary person, I want to be somebody in heaven. I want to inherit the higher glory. Good. If you think you are strong enough for heavyweight championship, consider this calling. You must follow Jesus Christ, deny yourself, and be willing to die for him at any time. Love not your father, mother, son, daughter, wife, brother, and sisters for his sake. And give your things to the poor. This is a high calling for his bride. preacher show this calling to ordinary Christians, to threaten them and to deceive them to fake salvation by disobedience. It is a trap. This calling is real, but it's not for you. This is for you. You just love God and love the neighbor. For them, dedicate themselves. So two different, we just saw these two, and there's in between also. This calling is real, but many are not called for this. I am not. I'm not called for the high calling, and I know my calling, and I will remain there truthfully. I hope you will also. It makes us humble. If you like to study this about four heavens and this in detail, and I have the links in the description section, and it is with the transcript also, you can study it. What is our covenant with God for our eternal salvation? He is real. God is real. He is an omnipotent spirit. Jesus Christ is real here. Even if you don't see with your eyes, is real. Heaven is real and practical as anything else. But it is spiritual reality. Think of a flea market purchase where you pay $10 for $10,000 worth. You are going to God for this purchase. God is not a respecter of persons. Don't trust preachers. Preachers deceive you. You are not the sweetheart of God. Preachers say God loves you, for you alone he would have died, all this kind of garbage. Don't trust anything from them. You are just one among trillions before God. You are just one, you are nothing. But God considered everybody because everybody is his creation. Don't be deceived by sweet talk of preachers. Give very high honor and respect to God with love and fear. The Lord Jesus Christ is God. He is neither your brother nor your groom. Don't try to get familiar with him. He is God in the omnipotent spirit. God has four levels of heaven to offer his people. You are one among them, one among the people of God. That's trillions of people. And God knows what you can afford and how much you will strive for it. He will offer you the level that you can afford. Accept it with love, reverence, and fear. There will be no room for cheating, lie, eye service, or exploiting. God will also help you and work with you to fulfill the covenant. He is interested that you succeed. You and God will be a team if you are truthful to him. If you don't, you don't need a middleman. You and God alone. But don't get familiar. He's God and you are just a person. He's a creation. You have to keep that respect. You will inherit heaven if you are honest and obedient. Either you will be among the multitude, or you will be in the throne, or you will be in between. Wherever you are, you will be fully happy with, you will love it, you will enjoy it. This is your eternal salvation. Thank you for listening. May God bless you and be with you. Amen.